The mortal realms of the Age of Sigmar are incredibly varied, and they each have their own history and their own empires which have risen and fallen over the years, and we're going to look at a few of those today. The Great Parch is an area in Akshi which is a seriously large continent, and it's divided into several nations. We know a few of these already. We've seen the Flamescar Plateau, the Brimstone Peninsula, the areas in the middle of the Great Parch. Two of the richest nations are Batar and Asperia. Batar is all about merchants, rich precious metals, and trade routes. They are exceptionally good traders. Some call them greedy and selfish, but actually they have brought a lot of advancement to that area of the Great Parch. Asperia is more about enlightened arcane wizards. Lots of these guys, there was the Aglaraxia Empire, who some of you might know from the Flamescar Plateau and the Firestorm campaign. And they were really successful wizards. They did so many alchemical experiments that the sea all around their area has become polychromatic with all the alchemical runoff that comes out of their spires and their citadels. We also have some of the old enemies of the Forces of Order, such as the Skaven. They've burrowed out an area called Chakrik's Folly. Chakrik was a famous Skaven warlord who decided to claim an area of the Great Parch, but it is riven by earthquakes. It's on a fault line. And it was a really bad idea to claim that area. There's a reason why it was empty. But the Skaven just keep on rebuilding. Every time there's an earthquake, they just build up again. So the whole place is chasms and fissures and scaffolding. And every few weeks, it all comes tumbling down. But the Skaven don't give up easily, so they just rise to the top. They've infested that area. Gyron, the realm of life, was once beautiful, fertile paradises called the Jade Kingdoms. And admittedly, they had a great cycle, so they had death in there as well, and rebirth and resurrection. These were lands constantly going through the seasons, going through life, death, reincarnation. And needless to say, this attracted Nurgle. Nurgle, the grandfather of plagues, who very much coveted this land. Now, there's some areas of Gyron that are particularly magical and particularly potent. The Seeds of Hope grew to life in barely a day, really. They were magical cities that Alariel has sped up and fast-forwarded, especially the Living City, which is as much of tree and oak and bough as it is of stone. And that place is, that literally did grow up overnight and has become a great source of alliance between the Sylvaneth and the Free Peoples of Sigmar. The Phoenicium, the city of Amber Resurrection. This is known for its ability to bring people back to life, but a city was once lost. Essentially, the mountain erupted, not with lava, but with sap, with cloying amber realmstone sap that cascaded down this mountain and froze the city in place. And only over time have the elves and the phoenixes, their allies, managed to bring the city back to life and melt away that amber so it can thrive once more. Unfortunately, not all is rosy in Giran, as you might know. Nurgle has conquered so much of it that the vast majority is still full of suppurating quagmires, horrible stinking swamps, really twisted trees, and strange feculent gnarl moors that sprout everywhere. No more than the place called Invidia. Now, this was once a beautiful island, but has since been claimed by Horticulus Slimux, who some of you might know as the gardener of Nurgle, who rides around on this strange snail demon creature. And he has claimed this island for his own, and he's really messed it up. It's loads of Nurglings and Beasts of Nurgle frolicking around in putrescent reality sores, we call them. So like giant lakes that are in the shape of the icon of Nurgle. It's really not a good place to go on holiday. Shaiish, the realm of endings, the realm of death, we know a little bit about now because the Malign Portent stories and the Dread Solstice campaign. We spent a fair bit of time here. Shadespire, for example, the ruins of Shadespire, right there in the middle of this area, which we call the Prime Innerlands. Shaiish is known for its underworlds, one of which is Penultima. This is the area where Shadespire was once thriving as a metropolis. It grew to be very powerful, but then Nagash cursed it, as anyone who's played Shadespire will know, and sent its spirit hurtling into the void. The remnants are still there, like a bleached coral reef of a city, and some foolhardy slash brave treasure seekers will go in there and attempt to rescue its riches. The island of Styx is where the Anvils of the Heldenhammer make their base. Now, this is a very powerful storm host. They're very somber. They wear black armor, but they hail from all across history. These are heroes and heroines taken from across time, and so they speak in a quite archaic fashion. And their base, their Stormkeep, is in Lake Lethys. It's right on the edge of the lake in the city of Lethys. There is a great necropolis, and these people are used to defending it against undead and even chaos worshippers. There's a Slaanesh stronghold to the south of there, so they're no strangers to war. Some of Nagash's Mortarks, his lieutenants, have taken up residence in the Prime Inner Lands and tried to shape the lands a bit like the lands that they hail from, because the undead are very much into tradition and not big into imagination typically. So we have Neferata down there. She's formed New Lamia, which is full of pyramids and obelisks, areas that are reminiscent of her old haunting grounds, Nehekara. Similarly, Manfred von Karstein, he has an area called Karstinia that he has abdicated, essentially. Now, he fashioned this land to look very much like Sylvania, which is the land of his birth. He even had sort of puppet versions of his rivals, Vlad von Karstein, Isabella, Conrad von Karstein, that he used in his court. They were doppelgangers and fake rivals, essentially, that he caused to bow down to his throne, because that's what he'd always dreamt of. But he found it very hollow. He found that whole thing, it was a sham, essentially. So he's abdicated that throne and gone off in search of greater conquests elsewhere. Shamon, the realm of metal, is as known for its flux and its change as it is for actual metal, metallurgy, and alchemy. Now, this place is, as you may imagine, very rich in minerals. There's loads of gold, silver, platinum, even stranger precious metals there. And these get fashioned into super swords, incredible armor. And there's a lot of smiths and artificers here. And as a result, lots of riches and trade. Now, the Spiral Crux, which is what we're going to talk about now, is essentially a hub of that trade and a hub of industry. A massive area of the Spiral Crux, actually in the shape of the Sigil of Tzeentch, has been taken by Zangors, by sorcerers, by Mutalith vortex beasts. Zangor Coast, for example, is an area where the Zangor are hunting shipwrecks, they're salvaging essentially, but not from boats of wood and iron like we might imagine, more like flying skyships, airborne galleons from the Caradron overlords that they've managed to somehow scuttle or shipwreck, and they're there hunting through all the wreckage to find the magic artifacts inside. Scrapper Spill is a mountain in the southwest of the Spiral Crux. It's not a mountain of rock like we might imagine. Essentially, it's a pile of scrap. This is a trophy haven for greenskins and grots and ogres. Every time they killed somebody, they would put the swords or items that they didn't want into this trophy pile. The area around the center of the Spiral Crux is now so saturated in weird Tzeentch magic that it is extremely hazardous. Anyone going anywhere close without Tzeentch's blessing would mutate out of all control. But some of the sorcerers of Tzeentch find it very useful to use the energies there, and they've made this area called the God's Claw, full of strange spiral-shaped castles in which they perform their most mind-bending and strange spells in order to conquer the nature of reality. Ulgu, the realm of shadow, is a land of mist, fog, deception, and shrouded secrets. You don't wander in there lightly and come back out again. It's haunted by strange, freaky sights that would drive a sane man out of his mind in no time flat. And also, the forces of order that live there, I mean the people that want civilization and progress and want roads and lands where you can survive and thrive, they are essentially just as cutthroat and deceptive as the bad guys. We've got the Daughters of Cain. They thrive in Ulgu. They're almost natives of that land since Marathi settled there. But we also have odd liar tribes and weird shamans, and when they speak lies onto the wind, it forms a strange gossamer substance. Also, it's rumored that there are slinking rat men in the mists in there as well, the assassins of the Clans Eshin. And it's very likely you'll get a blade in the back if you go into the wrong area. Haish, the realm of light, is known for its blinding illumination. This place is full of symbolism, strange riddles, and intellectual pursuits. It's a haven for mages, for scholars, sages of all races. Once it was a place where people would go to learn and to learn about themselves, actually. There was a lot of spiritual enlightenment as well as intellectual enlightenment. And these people would pride themselves on becoming far more educated and clever than their neighbors. And in a way, that's how Chaos got its claws in, through that pride and through that slight competitiveness. Even though Haish is a place of illumination and of enlightenment, it has unfortunately been conquered by Chaos. And though we haven't really looked too far into it, over the coming years, we'll be able to tell you more about how that unfurled. The Realm of Beasts is a place where everything is feeding on everything else. It's all about predator and prey. Even the land masses, so the islands are trying to grind their way into the mainland to devour the earth. The mountains are moving overnight. If you went to sleep in Gur, you would awaken to see the mountain on the horizon had shifted slightly. The forests are growing on top of that mountain to try and conquer it, and the rivers are cutting their way through the hills, almost preying on those hills as they erode the rock. So everything's feeding on everything else. You get these massive mega predators. Of course, we know about the god beasts, but also you've got things that make a woolly mammoth look small by comparison are hunted by the bone splitter orcs of that realm, or the beast claw ogres who are constantly roaming ahead of the Everwinter. So it's a land of savagery, of prehistoric might, and of utter destruction. This is a place where orcs thrive. The worship of Gorka Morka is everywhere, and might definitely makes right. It's a place where the strongest survive. Azir, the realm of heavens, is a celestial paradise. It's full of gorgeous architecture, beautiful advancements. The people there are more or less content because there is no war here, or at least that's how Sigmar would have people believe. There are a few cracks in this wonderful facade of progress and enlightenment. If you look carefully enough, you can see that actually all is not well in Azir, and there's some events in its history that Sigmar would rather people didn't look closely at. But for now, it is a place of celestial fortitude. It's held back the forces of chaos, and it remains a base and a fortress for Sigmar to send his Stormcast Eternals into the realms and conquer the forces of chaos wherever he strikes. In the cold void of the ether, there exists something that is predatory and hideous, and that is called the Realm of Chaos. It's trying to encroach into all of the mortal realms and conquer them, bleed in through the realm gates, demonic manifestations. And it's really a place of nightmares. This is a place where human, elf, and dwarf minds have summoned the worst reflection of their personalities, and it's become real. And it's trying to break into reality. Khorne has his stronghold there, the Brass Citadel, the Circles of Slaanesh, the Crystal Labyrinth of Tsinch, and the Garden of Nurgle. And these are only the places that we can actually describe in mortal terms. There are boundless, kaleidoscopic, strange planes of existence out there in the Realm of Chaos. And it is coming, and it is trying to break through into reality, and it very nearly succeeded in capsizing the mortal realms altogether.